I'll warn you, class, after tonight's study, which I've titled Kill Jesus and Let the Thief Go, and next week's lesson titled How Great Is This Mercy? And then one more. Remember, you're to postpone deaths, funerals, births, everything. For 2 more weeks, Steve, and then you can do whatever you want. For the next 2 weeks, none of those things happening. God's telling you to be here. Because 2 weeks from tonight, the title of that lesson is, It Is Finished. Judy, you know, I grew up in a Christian home. I'm going to make a confession to you right now. I never knew all that It Is Finished included. And I told Penny, because I was just going over my notes when I left this afternoon to clean up and have dinner and then come back in. I said, Penny, I don't know if I can get through that lesson without tears. It just gets, I've told you this before, the closer you get to the event of the cross, the more glorious the good news is. I think I was telling Pat this week that I never realized till my own study of God's Word, that really, from cover to cover, there's only one theme. If you want to know what the whole Bible's about, it's about Christ. The whole Old Testament illustrates over and over again the need for Him and how there's no hope for us without Him. And the whole New Testament describes the wonderful blessing and joy of Him. It's just glorious, and the whole study reduces the Bible down to one central truth, and at the very foundation of that central truth of Christ is the cross. I never fully understood this before, and I don't claim to fully understand it now, but you'll see, beginning tonight, next week, and the next week, all that was accomplished there. Without the cross, there's nothing. We're still in darkness. We're still hopeless. Well, boy, God's Word is blessed. I can't believe I'm reading it now at my age, Judy, and it just gets more joyous and more joyous to where I can't contain the praise within me for what God continues to reveal to me. It means what Christ means to me. 1 John 4:10 says, in this is love, not that we love God. Here's the definition of love, John is saying. Not that you and I love God, but that He loved us and sent His Son to be the propitiation for our sins. Now, not that we love God means we were as opposed to God as we possibly ever could be. Before Christ brought light into us. And yet, in that as we could possibly ever be opposed to God, Christ loved us. Or, not that we love God means, when Pilate asked the crowd, as we'll see tonight, who should I release, Jesus or the crook? We were as much as among that crowd who demanded with them, kill Jesus and let the crook go. We were as much right there, we'll see tonight. That's how blind we were to truth. And yet God still loved you and me. If He hadn't, Steve, none of us would be here tonight. We've seen that over and over in Scripture. We're not here because of our own choosing. We may think we are. No. God chose us. He tells us in His Word, we've seen repeatedly, before we were ever formed in our mother's womb, before He ever created the foundations of the world, quote, in Scripture, He ordained for us to know Him. It's all been His doing that's brought us here to know the truth and to know the true truth that sets us free. and brings a peace and joy in our life that the world tries to find through drugs, sex, alcohol, pleasure, every kind of thing. But they can't find it because there's no true lasting peace in any of it. With that, let's begin point one in your outline, man's blindness without Christ. And we're picking up where we left off last week in John chapter 18, verse 19 to 21. And keep in mind, we're picking up right after Jesus was arrested by that squadron of 600 men, you remember? And they tied him up with a rope. And they felt now they had him under control. Verse 19. They took him to the high priest. The high priest then questioned Jesus about his disciples and about his teaching. Jesus answered him, "I've spoken openly to the world. I've always taught in synagogues and in the temple, where all the Jews come together, and I spoke nothing in secret. Why do you question me?" Jesus says to the high priest questioning him. Jesus says, "Question those who have heard what I spoke to them. They know what I said." Annas, the high priest here, and I'll have more to say about him in a minute, wanted to know specifically what Jesus was teaching around the province and what people were following him. He wanted to know this to determine if an insurrection was about to take place. Remember, in chapter 11, verse 48, the chief priests and Pharisees speaking said, "If we let him," referring to Jesus, "go on like this, all men will believe in him. And the Romans, whose authority they were under, will come and take away both our place and our nation." The Jews, again, were afraid the Romans would see Jesus as a threat to their authority and then clamp down on their religious ceremonies and worship. Jesus, however, says, back in the verses we just read, chapter 18, verses 20 to 21, that he has no secret agenda. He hasn't kept anything in secret. His teachings are widely known in the synagogue and in the temple. So the high priest or the Pharisees or anyone can just go ask any of the people what he's been saying, and they'll tell him. Well, in verse 22 and 23, when he'd said this, when Jesus gave this answer, one of the officers of the high priest standing nearby struck Jesus, saying, "Is that the way you answer the high priest?" Jesus answered him, "If I have spoken wrongly, testify of the wrong. But if rightly, why do you strike me?" So, one of Annas' handlers here slaps Jesus because of not liking his answer. Now, just pause for a minute and imagine a man slapping God. I mean, so much of this study brings into such clear view our blindness without Christ. And what God could have done instantly to everyone if he wanted to. This man, this handler of Annas, slapping Jesus just illustrates again how the world without Christ hates the truth. And it illustrates how all the motives of men, their human nature, and we see this throughout humanity, in life, the motives of men are irrational and unjust. There is no true justice in our, what we call, justice system today. The love that the world talks about today, that you turn on the TV and you hear marketed, is that true divine love? No, the love the world, only love the world knows, and they don't even realize it, is extremely selfish love. It's what I hope to get from you. Jesus' love was what he did for us because of who he is, not because of what he wanted anything from us or what we deserved. Amazing contrast between divine truth on every one of these subjects and human, what human life thinks it is. And it's no different today. We see it. So Jesus again answers. He said, if I've said something wrong, produce the evidence. But the officer wasn't interested. He just wanted to get the response that he wanted. Well, then verse 24. So Annas sent him bound. That's going to contain him. All tied up in ropes. He sends God tied up with ropes. To Caiaphas, the high priest. And then I want to jump ahead to verse 28 to 30. And you'll understand we're jumping ahead because the verses we're jumping over are the verses we considered last week in Peter's denial of Christ. We covered them last week. So ahead to verse 28. Then they led Jesus from Caiaphas into the praetorium. Now the praetorium simply was Pilate's official residence while he was in Jerusalem. So think of it as his house while he was there. And he administered the affairs of this province from there on behalf of Rome. Then they led Jesus from Caiaphas into the praetorium, and it was early. And they themselves, they being the Pharisees, the scribes, the religious leaders, they themselves did not enter into the praetorium, let's say Pilate's house, so that they would not be defiled, but might eat the Passover. What? What's this mean? We'll see in a minute. Therefore, Pilate went out of his house to them and said, "What accusation do you bring against this man?" They answered and said to him, "If this man were not an evildoer, we would not have delivered him to you." Now, see what this is about. Pilate was a Gentile, not a Jew, a Gentile. And Peter said in Acts 10:28, we won't take the time to turn there, but Peter said there that it was unlawful for a Jew to keep company with a Gentile. So, if these Pharisees, being Jews, went into Pilate's quarters or into Pilate's house, they'd be defiled for 7 days. And oops, you know what that meant? Passover is soon starting. And that would mean they won't be able to go to the Passover feast. That's what was on their mind. Staying not defiled, staying pure, absolutely pure, so they can go to the Passover feast. So, again, they didn't go into Pilate's residence yet. While they were being so careful to not defile themselves in this way, are we understanding? They were plotting to kill the very Christ that the Passover celebrated. I'm just pausing for a minute because I've had to pause a lot longer than this to just contemplate the magnitude of this delusion. They don't want to go into that house and get dirty. These are religious leaders. They're going to keep themselves pure because they're going to go celebrate the Passover feast. Which totally was all about and looked forward to Christ, the true Lamb of God that would shed His blood as the forgiveness of sins. And they want to be sure to go there. And while they're trying to make sure they're staying pure and not going into Pilate's house, they're at the very same time plotting to kill the Christ of the Passover. Then also, remember I said I'd come back and make a further comment about Annas? Annas, the high priest, had just been replaced by Caiaphas. And both these men were considered by all the Jews to be the men most dedicated to God. I mean, many Christians, and I'm not making a personal comment here, but many Christians would think of them as two Billy Grahams or two Apostle Pauls. Oscar, they were the highest of the high in religious authority and in living by the law. In fact, the current high priest, Caiaphas, was the only one who could enter the Holy of Holies once a year on behalf of the people. Yet, both these men are now also participating in calling for the death of the God they claim to honor. And God has revealed to you, He's brought light into the darkness that you once had. Or you'd still be with everybody else out on the street. You try to talk to them about Christ and they say, get the hell out of my face. But you know in your heart that the Christ that came to earth of the cross 2,000 years ago is nothing less than God and God's gift of eternal life to you and I. You and I know that. We know that as sure as we get up and breathe air in the morning. The only way you know that is God gave you that understanding. Without that, you and I would still be as blind as these two high priests, that one of them going into the Holy of Holies once a year to honor God Almighty and coming out of there. And now, being a part of the crowd that's demanding, kill Jesus and let the thief go. You can't make this study and you can't understand this without your heart just repeatedly saying, praise the Lord, praise the Lord, praise the Lord, for what He's revealed to me. I'll tell you what, I also want us to realize here, and this may take me an extra minute, but I want to share it with you. This blindness of the Pharisees and these men is the same blindness that's still in our flesh apart from the Holy Spirit's leading in our life. Do we realize that? I often hear Christians tell one another, having lived as many years as I have, in order to make a decision to do something, you need to make a list. And you put the pros on one side and the cons on the other, and whichever is the longest, you go by that. You've heard that, Aaron. Well, our fleshly thinking is just as blind. about 5 years ago, that's 5 years after we built this building, I purchased the 2.5 acres next door. It's vacant. You just go out there and you'll see right across from the federal courthouse, it's vacant. And the Lord put on my heart to buy it for expansion. Well, 2 years ago, we even had plans drawn to build a bigger building and lease this building. I presented it to the staff in this room right here, around a table. Now, I want to tell you something. When I made that list in my mind as to what's for this and what's against it, everything that I could think of was in favor of building that building. There was not one reason against it. But Bill, financing the building and pulling this whole thing off financially was hugely contingent on renting this building. And several realtors that knew I was considering this, I had them knocking down my door because they wanted the commission, telling me, well, I can get you a renter, I can get you a renter, I can get you a renter. But you know what? As I set aside the list and said, Lord, you make me to know, Oscar, he never gave me that peace to move forward. And I sat up there behind my desk so many months and thought, it makes sense in every way to break ground to build that building. But I just don't have a peace about it. I told my staff that. You see, the list of pros and cons can't foresee the future, but the Holy Spirit does. And no one knew 6 months later the economy was going to go off the cliff. And if I was moving in that building just about now, I wouldn't have a prayer of renting this building. All the other office buildings up and down the street that I drive by and the Lord reminds me of it all the time are vacant. Remember, our flesh is just as blind. That's why the scripture tells us, Proverbs 3, 5, and 6. I don't have it up here on the screen. Trust in the Lord with all your heart. What's the next phrase? Lean not on your list. Right? Isn't that what it says? Paraphrase. Daryl's paraphrase. Lean not on your own understanding. In all your ways, acknowledge Him. Be sensitive to the Spirit's leading, and He will direct your steps. What a powerful lesson to me. Chris, you know I drive to work every day. I see those empty buildings. And I think of the power of God keeping me from going off a cliff with the business, financially, and everything else. Well, then second we see here in our study, prophecy again fulfilled. And this again is important for us to see because it proves the authenticity of Scripture and reminds us that all that Scripture promises you and me will prove true. For example, when Scripture promises that we're saved forever, that will prove true. When we're going to see here in a few minutes, prophecy fulfilled again, just as that was proven true, and we see what was said several thousand years ago coming true, just as God is telling us now. I'm saving you forever. We will see in glory that will prove true. And when God says in Romans 8:28 that He's working all bad things in our life out for our good, we will see some of that here and some of that later in glory. We will see that all proved true. Every single bad thing God worked out for our good. Verse 31 and 32. So Pilate said to them, take him yourselves. He said this back to the Pharisees and the crowd. Take him yourselves and judge him according to your law. The law of the Jews. Remember, Pilate was a Gentile. He operated under Roman law. He's saying to the crowd and to the Pharisees, which are Jews, take him and judge him according to your laws. The Jews said to him, we're not permitted to put anyone to death. to fulfill the word of Jesus, which he spoke, signifying by what kind of death he was about to die. So again, Pilate says to the Jews, you take Jesus and judge him by your own law, and the Jews required, we can't. We can't put him to death. And this was true as it regarded how Scripture said Jesus would die, the means by which he'd die. Jewish law only permitted someone to be stoned to death. Roman law, which the Jews were living under, permitted crucifixion for capital punishment. And Jesus prophesied hundreds of years before he would be lifted up on a cross. That's how he'd die. He'd be crucified. John 3:14 says, quoting, as Moses lifted up the serpent in the wilderness, even so must the Son of Man be lifted up, not stoned. John 12:32 to 33 says, and if I am lifted up, Jesus speaking here, meaning on a cross from the earth, will draw all men to myself. But he was saying this to indicate the kind of death by which he was to die. So, in order for prophecy to be fulfilled, Jesus had to be crucified under Roman law. So, Pilate was trying to throw this back into the lap of the Jews, and the Jews said, none of them knowing God was orchestrating all of this in a way that was fulfilling prophecy. They couldn't put him to death. It had to go back to Pilate. Then also, crucifixion was a sign of being cursed by God. Deuteronomy 21, verses 20 to 23 say, if a man has committed a sin worthy of death, and he is to be put to death, and you hang him on a tree or on a cross, his corpse shall not hang all night on the tree, but you shall surely bury him the same day. For he who is hanged is accursed of God. Anybody hanged was a sign they were cursed by God, so that you do not defile your land which the Lord your God gives you as an inheritance. So if Jesus was crucified, the Jews thought that would forever discredit any claims he made to being God. He was cursed by God. But the man that all of this is discussing, being God, instead proved through his crucifixion that he was God. Because it again fulfilled prophecy, and Christ, as we know, rose from the dead 3 days later. So what does all this mean for you and me? It means man can never alter or stand in the way of God's plan. That's a glorious truth. Here you have the powers that be trying to get rid of Jesus. That's wrong enough, but get rid of him in a way that Jesus didn't prophesy. That wasn't going to happen. It's going to happen according to Scripture, exactly the way he said. Jesus had to be crucified on a cross. And even though Pilate tried his best to get it handled a different way, God's way prevailed. You know what this means to me, Steve? This means to me that not even our flesh, our ugly flesh, can stand in the way of what God desires to accomplish in our life. I can't tell you as I wrote these notes. Well, I had one praise the Lord that my secretary typed, and I put two more times down here through the bottom of the page in red ink. See that, Oscar? I just had to say, praise the Lord, praise the Lord. And if the page went on, I'd still be saying, praise the Lord. Praise God. Greater is he that is in me than he that is in my flesh. Well, then third, chapter 18 concludes. Boy. Just several hours. before Christ is actually crucified. That'll be our lesson next week and concluding the following week. The chapter concludes with the crowd saying, "Kill Jesus and let the thief go." Verse 33 to 35. "Therefore, Pilate entered again into the praetorium," back into his headquarters, his house, "and summoned Jesus and said to him, 'Are you the king of the Jews?' Jesus answered, 'Are you saying this on your own initiative? Or did others tell you about me?' Pilate answered, 'I am not a Jew, am I?'" Meaning, "I'm not a Jew. "Your own nation and the chief priests delivered you to me." Your own religious people delivered you to me. "What have you done?" So Pilate asked Jesus in verse 33 if he is the king of the Jews. Then in verse 34, Jesus asks, "Do you personally want to know, Pilate? Or are you just asking because others put you up to it?" Then in verse 35, Pilate is trying to understand what claim the Jews had against him. Then in verse 36, Jesus answered, "My kingdom is not of this world. If my kingdom were of this world, then my servants would be fighting so that I would not be handed over to the Jews. But as it is, my kingdom is not of this realm." So Jesus replies to Pilate that he is a king. He's got that right. But he's a king of an entirely different realm. Meaning, his kingdom is not like any in this world that Pilate knows. Also, Jesus is implying here to Pilate that his kingship is not one the Roman world would feel threatened by. It doesn't have anything to do with here. Wouldn't you love at this point to get into Pilate's mind? Well then, verse 37. "Therefore, Pilate said to him, 'So you are a king.' Jesus answered, 'You say correctly that I am a king. For this I have been born, and for this I have come into the world, to testify to the truth. Everyone who is of the truth hears my voice.'" Now, I just praise God, because throughout Scripture, he tucks away assurance after assurance of our salvation, because he doesn't want any of us doubting it or worrying about it. Look at it here in this verse. First, Jesus says here, "I am a king. For this I have been born." I was born for this. He's also saying in that statement that he existed before this time, when he says he was born for this. So he's implying to Pilate he has to be God. Then also, here again is just another reference to those of us who are of God's sheepfold, knowing that we are, because we hear God's voice. Again, we hear God's voice by God's word is truth to us. The rest of the world doesn't care about this, doesn't believe it, but it's truth to us. We hear God's voice because when we read God's word, it encourages us. Most of you have told me you miss when we don't have the Bible study in the summer because you get such a fresh feeding of encouragement week after week. And so do I, through hearing God's word. We feel it influencing our life. All of these things, our hearing God's voice in these ways, is absolute assurance we are of God's sheepfold. Praise the Lord. He just said there, everyone who is of the truth hears my voice. Not should hear, not must hear, but everyone who is of the truth, divine truth, belongs to God, hears, is encouraged by my word, attracted to my word, has a growing understanding of it because I'm producing that in their life. Is this glorious? So again, our attraction to God and His Word proves we're saved. It has nothing to do with how many times you sin disapproving it or you didn't get to witness this month or this year. Our attraction to God and His Word proves we're saved. Praise God. Steve, I can't tell you how much I praise God for this simple assurance. Because I told you, for the first 40 years of my life, my greatest fear was, will I really wake up in heaven when I die? This is such great freedom to me. And I think that's why God tucked it away in every page of Scripture. He loves you and me that much. He wants to remind us. Then back to chapter 18 and verse 38. Pilate said to him, what is truth? Oh, I skipped a verse, didn't I? Do we have time to go back to it? 1 John 4:6. Can you put it back? Yeah, 1 John 4:6. We are from God. That means we are of God's sheepfold. He who knows God listens to us. This is John speaking, and he's saying, everybody that's of God's sheepfold, everybody that knows God, listens to us. John is proclaiming God's word. So when he says listens to us, he means listens to God's word being preached. He has an attraction to that. He who is not from God does not listen to us. This simply means isn't interested in the things of God. Isn't that clear, Steve? He who is not from God does not listen to us. Doesn't have any attraction to the things of God. Real clear. By this we know the spirit of truth and the spirit of error. Praise God for the simplicity of His word and the simplicity of knowing we belong to God. Well, then back to John 18 and verse 38. Pilate said to him, what is truth? And when he had said this, he went out again to the Jews and said to them, I find no fault. Or he says, I find no guilt in him. Now, some translations read what I just spoke. I find no fault in him. And Pilate's words here again are a fulfillment of Scripture. Very interesting fulfillment of Scripture. Because as the lamb sacrifice in the Old Testament, which signified Christ's coming sacrifice, had to be unblemished. Or had to be a lamb without fault. Exodus 12:5 says, your lamb shall be an unblemished male. A year old, you may take it from the sheep or from the goat. So when Pilate said, I find no fault in him, in just those words, which God caused him to speak, of course, he unknowingly was declaring Jesus to be a qualified sacrifice for you and us. Isn't that interesting? Then, verse 39 to 40. But you have a custom, Pilate says. You have a custom that I release someone for you at the Passover. Do you wish then that I release for you the king of the Jews? So they cried out again, saying, not this man, not Jesus, but Barabbas. Now Barabbas was a robber. or in some of your translations, a thief. In others of your translations, a crook. We can't stand the thought of you releasing this Jesus. Now remember, the two high priests are in on this. The official one in office at the point in time going into the Holy of Holies in representing the people to honor the how great thou art God. He's in on this. The Pharisees and the scribes are in on this. And they're all saying, no, don't let Jesus go. We got to do away with God and let the crook go. So when you think about this, what you realize is John ends this chapter. Interesting. Ends the chapter just before Jesus is crucified, actually killed, by contrasting the depravity of man, dead in our trespasses and sins, and God's great forgiveness here. Consider this, and I'm through in 1 minute. But I want you to consider this as the Lord caused me to. Man here in his darkness, the religious leaders are insisting on killing the only source of their forgiveness. Or they're insisting on killing the only hope they have. Or they're insisting on killing their own salvation. Yet, as we'll see next week, praise God, His love for you and I is greater than the hell within you and I. By that I mean, even though we all, because the crowd represents you and I. Even though we all said with the crowd, we were as much as standing there in total darkness of understanding the truth about Christ and the lostness of our depravity. We all were as much as standing there together with the crowd saying, let the thief go free. Yet what are we going to see next week? Christ still chose to go to the cross so we could go free. And when I got to here, I could only conclude with the question, how great a love is this? It's beyond definition. Now we're only several hours from the cross. I wish we could continue to it because it truly gets even more greater next week. See you.